Hello friends, I am Dr. Sharad Binnor, working as Associate Professor in the Department of English of KTHM College, Nashik. Today we are going to study a topic, what is poetry, from the section Theory of Poetry of Discipline Specific Course DSC 2A entitled as Appreciating Poetry. Objectives of this session are to introduce students to the genre of poetry. The second objective is to discuss various definitions of poetry. And the last objective is to enable students to understand the form of poetry. Poetry is one of the oldest genres in literary history. Its earliest examples go back to ancient Greek literature. In spite of this long tradition, it is difficult to define it than any other genre. Poetry is closely related to the term lyric, which derives etymologically from the Greek musical instrument lyre, meaning harp, and points to an origin in the sphere of music. In classical antiquity, as well as in the Middle Ages, minstrels recited poetry accompanied by the lyre or other musical instruments. The term poetry, however, goes back to the Greek word poio, meaning to make or to produce, indicating that the poet is the person who makes verse. Although etymology sheds light on some of the aspects of the lyric and the poetic, it cannot offer a satisfactory explanation of the phenomenon as such. Most traditional attempts to define poetry juxtapose poetry with prose. The majority of these definitions are limited to characteristics such as verse, rhyme and meter, which are traditionally regarded as the classical elements which distinguish poetry from prose. These criteria, however, cannot be applied to modern prose poetry or experimental poetry. Explanations of the genre which combine poetic language with linguistic elements other than rhyme and meter do more justice to non-traditional forms such as free verse or prose poems. The genre of poetry is often subdivided into two major categories of narrative and lyric poetry, which we will discuss in our next session. As stated earlier, poetry is really very difficult to define. However, many poets and scholars have tried to define poetry. Let us discuss some of these poems. Still, none of these definitions give us a complete picture of what is poetry. Samuel Johnson defines poetry as a metrical composition. So, poetry is a metrical composition. Here he referred to the metrical form of poetry. In his days or earlier, poems were written in meter, and they are still written in meter, though we have forms like free verse. So this definition is incomplete because it just refers to the metrical form of poetry. It does not account for the poems which are not written in meter. For Carlyle, poetry is a musical thought. Here Carlyle thinks that poetry is the expression of thought in a rhythmic way through music. It is also a very incomplete sort of definition. A very detailed sort of a definition is given by William Wordsworth, which is very famous and most of us knows it. That is, poetry is the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings. It takes its origin from emotions recollected in tranquility. You all know that in his preface to Lyrical Ballad, Wordsworth propounded his views on poetry, its nature and function, and the qualification of a true poet. So far as the nature of poetry is concerned, Wordsworth is of the opinion that poetry is the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings. Poetry has its origin in the internal feelings of the poet. It is a matter of passion, mood, and temperament. Poetry cannot be produced by strictly following the rules laid down by the classicists. It must flow out naturally and smoothly from the soul of the poet. But it must be noted that good poetry, according to Wordsworth, is never an immediate expression of such powerful feelings. A good poet must ponder over them long and deeply. In the words of Wordsworth, poetry has its origin in emotions recollected in tranquility. For him, there are four stages which play a very crucial role in converting an experience into a pleasing composition. First comes observation or perception of some object, character, or incident which sets up powerful emotions in the mind of the poet. Next comes the contemplation or recollection of that emotion in tranquility. It must be noted that at this stage, memory comes into play and brings out what has been lying in the unconscious for days, months, or years. A similar kind of incident triggers the poet to visit the past experiences stored in the unexplored regions of his mind. The third stage is that of filtering, wherein the poet is purged of non-essential elements and thus makes his experience communicable to all men. The fourth stage is when the actual composition begins. The poet seeks to convey his emotions through print and turns into a communicator. In the words of Wordsworth, he becomes a man speaking to men. What is important to him is not just expressing his joy, but sharing it with his readers. P.B. Shelley defines poetry as the record of the best and happiest moments of the happiest and best minds. To him, poetry in a general sense may be defined as the expression of imagination. So, according to Shelley, poetry is the record of the best and happiest moments, but not of ordinary minds, but of the happiest and noblest minds such as poets. When he say poetry is the expression of imagination, he refers to one of the most important elements of poetry, that is imagination. Matthew Arnold thinks that poetry is at bottom a criticism of life, that the greatness of a poet lies in his powerful and beautiful application of ideas to life, to the question how to live. According to him, poetry presents evaluation of life, that is criticism of life, and in the application of noblest ideas to life lies the greatness of a great poet, or those who are really worthy poets. Poets answer the question how to live. So poetry enables us to understand life properly. So also, it gives us a purpose to live. It offers us the true meaning of life. Why we are living? What is the purpose of our life? Let us take some more definitions. According to Robert Frost, poetry is when an emotion has found its thought and the thought has found words. Robert Frost here talks of transforming emotions into appropriate thoughts and then expressing these thoughts in proper words. But this is also not a proper definition of poetry. T.S. Eliot. for T.S. Eliot, poetry is not a turning loose of emotions, but an escape from emotion. It is not the expression of personality, but an escape from personality. But of course, only those who have personality and emotions know what it means to want to escape from these things. For T.S. Eliot, writing poetry can indeed be an escape from emotions and personality. For others, poetry is actually a way of or way to process their emotions and demonstrate who they are. You all know that Eliot was a champion of impersonality. That is, the poet's personality does not matter, as it's the poetry that he or she produces that is important. Famously, he observed, poetry is not a turning loose of emotion, but an escape from emotion. He says that it is not the expression of personality, but an escape from personality. But only those who have personality and emotions know what it means to want to escape from these things. This is more or less a direct criticism of William Wordsworth's poetry, where he says that poetry is the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings. Once again, Eliot sets himself apart from such a romantic notion of poetry. This is in keeping with his argument about the importance of tradition. The poet's personality does not matter, only how their work responds to and fits into the poetic tradition that matters. There are many definitions of poetry available, but the definitions discussed here are suffice to indicate the difficulty in defining the concept of poetry. There are a number of outward signs that indicate a poem. Most obviously, the individual text lines in poetry do not fill the entire width of the page. Thus, before they have actually started reading, means readers of poetry are given an instant indication that what they are going to read is probably a poem. In consequence, a reader's attention is likely to focus on poetic features of the text. Poetry is often associated not only with specialized language, but with a very dense use of such specialized language. Poems usually try to express their meaning in much less space than, say, a novel or even a short story. Alexander Pope once explained that he preferred to write poetry even when he wrote about philosophy, because it enabled him to express himself more briefly in his preface to An Essay on Man. As a result of its relative brevity, poetry tends to make more concentrated use of formal elements. We will discuss the elements of poetry in our next lecture. Thank you very much for your patient listening. If you have any queries or questions, feel free to post them on our Google Classroom. I'll try to answer all your queries and questions. Thank you once again.